Think about how traumatic car accidents are for us, and we know what happened.
I don't know nobody else is doing this. Body start to drop, ay, hit the floor.
Welcome back to the channel. We are in the big town. I don't know actually what town we're in, but we're in Tennessee. It's a small little town. I'm excited to be here. We just had Cracker Barrel. We're gonna go in and get to work. And I'm excited for you guys to see what's going on in here with this service dog. Hey. Hey again.
Hi.
Hello, how are you?
So I've actually been with Stormi. She'll be 3 in December, and she has completely changed our lives. I have a neuromuscular disease called myasthenia gravis, and it is actually in the family of generalized, which affects every voluntary muscle in my body. And what makes MG fatal is your diaphragm is a voluntary muscle. So with Stormi, she has one primary tasking, which is scent training, and it's for emergency medication. Because of how I respond to that medication and how it does immediately alleviate the emergency situation, in my scenario, it has been a perfect match for us. And medical stability I didn't have before. So we were doing great, we were a wonderful working team, and unfortunately we were in a car accident.
The dog was just going down the road, assumably like she has every other car ride, and then boom, out of nowhere, they were in a very tragic type of accident.
She still was working, she was doing great at home. But when we got to different environments where that wasn't her safe place anymore, we regressed. What do we do now? Where do we go from here?
It was so scary for the dog, and so maybe that's really ruining a lot of what she assumed was okay is now not okay. So these are the problems that we're having. They haven't been able to go out with success without the dog shutting down, without the dog really putting on the brakes and not going into places.
And so that is where we asked for help, because we got to a point where we needed to make a decision. Can we recover from this? And what is the best and healthiest option for my dog? Because that's always the number one thing in my mind is what's the best for my dog. I think that now she's becoming frustrated because we're getting to that point. She's kind of building that confidence back.
Yeah.
She's frustrated because she's not working.
Yeah.
But then she gets out there and she's like, oh, I'm just kidding.
So what does she do when you bring her out?
We get in the car, we go down the road, we get in the parking lot. We wouldn't even be walking. She's complete shutdown. Sit. Yes. Yes.
So this is it right here, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
No. She goes flat. I mean, she's gone. Leave it. Good girl. Leave it. She should be looking at me when we're inside the store. She should be just like that. If I'm stopped, she can come in front of me. She can come beside me, because if for any reason I do go down, I can grab onto her side. So now she's happy. Now she wants to work.
Yeah, and it's hard for me, like, because I don't know her that well, it's hard for me to distinguish when she's on and when she's not.
Yeah. So she's at me. She's looking at me. Her nose is nearest to my body instead of her nose being out.
Like, can you test her? Like, do you have a cue to say, like, hey, I need...
If I'm kind of feeling a little off, I'll say check. And then she will sniff me. And if it's there, she will either lick my gland or she'll bump me in the face.
What I would do is really spend some time desensitizing the door. So say you're coming into this big box, basically, right? And the doorway to the box is what she has a hard time with. It almost boosts her anxiety and boosts her stress for whatever reason. So when she gets in there, she goes vroom. And when she gets, you know, walks out, it's the same thing. So what I would do is desensitize this area.
She okay. won't take a treat. We've tried raw hamburger. We've sat there.
You don't have to give her treats.
Okay.
That's like the reward over this is very long, like down the road. So what I want to do is I want to work on this threshold.
Okay.
And what I want you to do is give her pressure if she pulls you. You in this equation have to be the calmest.
Yeah.
Typically I would say, let me show you, but because she's a service dog slash a dog that wants to be with you outside of the service, it's hard. So you just want to work on this insecure area here. And when
she's totally fixated on him.
Yeah, she shouldn't even care that he's there.
Mm-hmm.
It's like she's never worked PA in her life.
Right, there's two different things going on.
Mm-hmm.
There's the work, mm-hmm. and then there's the behavior, which mm-hmm. are separate.
Yeah.
They coexist with each other. Because the behavior is not letting the work happen. but like you're building two different things up.
She knows what I'm trying to do. She knows I'm trying to go out.
Yeah.
Let's go. Let's go.
Okay, well, here, just put this on. Now, this time what I want you to do is when you go and she gives you pressure, I want you to just get to the end of this and give her a little bit of pressure. So
all the way out.
Yeah, I'll walk you through it.
Okay.
Pop. And then keep your momentum moving forward. There you go. Now
good
keep
girl.
Going.
Yes.
Now,
good girl.
Yep, there you
Let's
go.
Let's go.
Take your time here. So if she rushes you, just give her pressure.
Good girl.
There you
good
go.
Girl.
So you see that pressure?
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're missing is this collar doesn't have action. The slip that has action allowed you to give her pressure forward. Did you see the difference?
Yes, absolutely.
Let's say that that leaf right there is the door. What you want to do is go forward. If she pulls and goes, she escapes out. She's like, I gotta go. You stop. Nope, it's a little bit of a compulsion training where you're making her deal with this. Like if she's terrified of this and she's like this and she walks by and she's just constantly like this, what you want to do is get her right here and then she's like, and you do that constantly and it'll desensitize her. But like that was that door.
Right, which is exactly like hitting us in a car.
I'm absolutely so grateful and happy that you guys are here on this channel watching this video. Do me a favor if you haven't yet, consider subscribing to my channel. We put videos out like this every single week. We are almost at a huge milestone of 500,000 subscribers right here on YouTube, which is huge. My mind is blown. Thank you guys so much for the support. Moving forward, subscribe, turn on your notification bell so we can continue to grow this No Bad Dog Army and help dog owners all around the world. What is she doing?
She will not come out. She's starting to drip.
I would just put the slip on. Come on, babe. Good girl. Just a little bit of pressure. All right, I'm just gonna put the 2.25 on. So even like this is good for her,
yeah,
the desensitization.
Yeah. See how she's like full body quivering now? Because we're in a high volume.
It's not too bad.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, she's nervous, yeah. She's nervous. I was talking to Abby on the way over here. She went through a traumatic experience. And with us, like think about how traumatic car accidents are for us and we know what happened.
Right.
With dogs, all of a sudden they're driving what they think is an everyday thing and then poof, it's like this life-changing thing. So she's got PTSD from things that she thought were okay and are not anymore. So it's just gonna take some time. We have to have empathy, but we have to have structure, just like with kids, with people, really. Like I know this is gonna be uncomfortable for you, but you have to move through it and that's what we're kind of pushing her forward. Hey you guys, we're doing a giveaway on the Tom Davis Dogger 280C on this video. All you have to do to enter to win is subscribe to my channel, turn on your notification, like this video, and leave a comment down below to enter to win. All right, so right now what we're doing is we're trying to figure out a great way to have this dog almost soak and marinate into these situations. Because again, we don't wanna like push her to a point where it's like not beneficial for her, but at the same time, what we really need to do is make sure that she's understanding that these loud noises, the trucks, the doors opening up at the grocery store, the people slamming carts around, these things need to kind of soak in so she realizes that it's okay and it's not gonna be as scary as she thinks it's going to be.
Good girl, yes.
Basically what you're doing is you're pulling her to that little area because like I said before, it's kind of like this speed bump where she gets a speed bump and she does this and then she goes back down.
Right.
So that speed bump is that area.
Okay.
So what you need to do is make sure that when you hit that speed bump, slow everything down and take your time over it. That's why we pulled off to the side and just relaxed right there.
Okay.
And she's stressed, but it's kind of like flooding her with that information.
Good girl.
And then
yes,
that way
ma'am.
When you get back out on this floor, she's like, no big deal. What you should do too is go out, come back in, go out, come back in, go out, come back in, and just kind of do a circle. And just, good girl, good girl, good girl, and just make it as fun as you possibly can.
If I try to come out and I'm weak and I'm alone or whatever, it's like I don't have the strength to stop her.
Right. That's where the prong collar comes in. Is it's gonna be the safest tool for you to use because if she decides to get, like say a little kid grabs her tail or somebody hits her with a cart and she's already, and then she flies, like then you go down and, all that stuff. So whenever you're ready, I think we should just go
walk
around and having her smell these things, having her feel the floor with her pads, like all of that is good desensitization. But this is good. So this is her calm.
This is my Stormi girl.
So now we close that book. Okay, now we're calm. Now we open up the other page and the other chapter of like, now you have to become a service dog again.
Okay. Right here.
Good girl.
Yes. Okay. Check. Check. She's not interested.
Mm-hmm. We're gonna keep working at it.
Yeah.
I mean, because we've already kind of gone through some milestones that you wanted to do, I mean, I have a lot of hope for it. All right, you guys, so yesterday was the first session, kind of meeting what's going on. There's a lot of complexities to this situation because we're doing service dog training, which service dog training is very, very particular per the dog, per the handler. So it's hard for me to make decisions on what we should or shouldn't do because I don't want to mess any of the service dog training up. There's also some PTSD slash insecure slash traumatic experience kind of training going on where the dog is now fearful of certain things because of that car accident that they had. So this is an interesting case that I'm sure you guys are following along with closely because this is something that we haven't seen on the channel before because we don't work with a ton of service dogs on some of this modification stuff. So yesterday we felt the dog out a little bit. Now today what we're doing is we're gonna go to more public access places and we're gonna really start figuring out what we need to do for the dog and handler to be successful.
Yes. Yes, good girl.
Is that better?
That's better.
So you
still
have to,
still a little bit, but not as.
So those are the things that you want to work on. Okay. Go ahead. Like if you have one kink and you only work on it once a day, it's not going to get better. So that's why the stairs, like if she has a problem going up the stairs, do it 3 to 5 times. If we feel like this isn't as good as it needs to be, in, out, till it gets to that point.
Yes.
That was better.
Good girl.
So what we're doing is she just has a hard time with these thresholds. So we're having her soak in this threshold because I find that if we just kind of hop over, oh, that's scary. They're never going to get over it. So we're spending time in that threshold that she has a hard time with. The other thing that you guys saw, which you may not have been able to saw yesterday at Target, was she doesn't like these doors. It makes the noise that she doesn't like. It kind of triggers her, if you will. And so when she gets closer to the door, she shuts down. So instead of trying to, and this goes for any dog, instead of trying to fight, what she wants, give her what she wants for five feet that way. We break her out, we build momentum, and we go right through it again. So that's what we're working on right here, just so you guys know. We're working on these thresholds and desensitizing these thresholds. And this goes for any dog, if they're afraid of anything, is you just kind of have them soak. It's gonna be stressful for them for a little bit till they can get over it. Good girl. That's where you would, in the future, pay her.
Okay.
Don't like break yourself trying to pay her. Just tell her good girl.
Good girl.
You don't have to give her a treat.
Good girl.
Good.
Yes.
Good girl. Room in the mullet. Good. Good. Now just bring her back over a little bit.
Come.
So what do you do here?
Yeah, I don't know.
Circle around and then go back.
Up. Come, heel. Heel.
Good, and then back through. Good.
Come. Good girl.
Good, let her do that for right now.
Okay.
Because the scary thing is this.
Okay.
So if she wants to, she's basically saying like, I want to hang out with Tom because Tom's not making me work right now. So again, we are constantly going back and forth and toggling between service dog training and building her confidence.
Yeah.
The confidence building is going to be the hardest part. Yeah. The service dog training, she understands her task and she'll do them when she's confident.
Yeah.
So if we have an opportunity, we have to just say, okay, now we're not service dog training, now we're building confidence.
Right.
Do you understand?
Absolutely.
Okay, cool. So that was perfect. So she was really afraid of this and now she's doing better with it.
Oh, good girl. Good girl.
That's good. So as you guys can see here at Eddie Bauer, she's struggling with these loud noises and these sudden movements. My goal isn't to completely make her, I mean, it would be nice for her to go completely back to normal, but I know dealing with traumatic experiences with PTSD, it's not gonna be possible to go back exactly the way that we were. In these situations, my job and my goal is just to help the dog have less anxiety, have less weariness of these loud noises, and that's what we're doing here. So right now, we have to blend the perfect amount of structure and empathy and understanding of like, hey, I know that these cars that are passing are nervous for you because of the accident. I know that the doors clashing in and out and the air coming down and loud noises randomly going off are gonna be scary for you, but it's our job to give the dog structure and to give the dog confidence to move forward and say, hey, this is okay. So really what we're doing right now and later in this video you guys will see is desensitizing some of these things. If we can take a very scary thing for her and make it progressionally better and not scary, that's what we need to do. If we can go this much, we can go this much. And that's gonna be the goal of this video.
Perfect.
was nice. That was really nice. That was really good.
Sorry, I got too excited.
Yeah, that was good. So that to me, when you walked in, was so like,
yeah,
like really nice. But I think you have to, when you're doing that and you're going through those situations, you want to break it down. Because if you make it really hard at first, after it's not gonna be hard, you know? I feel like I'm preaching right now. It's like, you're gonna go through that really hard time and it's gonna suck and it's gonna be stressful.
Yeah.
But once you get through it and you kind of fight the waves and you weather the storm, yeah, the next time you go through it, it's like really easy to pass right through. And that's what that was. Super, super stoked. We just found out that there's actually a wolf sanctuary here. And maybe you do not know, I volunteered 5 years at a wolf sanctuary in Colorado. So I had quite some experience working with wolves in the beginning of my career. I'm so excited to go check these wolves out. And I'm sure you guys will enjoy seeing them too. Someone's about to get corrected. So when wolves bark, it's not like how a dog barks. It's more of an aggravated, frustrated thing. But you can see as soon as this one wolf got up, all the other wolves got excited. When I volunteered at Mission Wolf in Colorado, I would just do this, as I would literally just spend all day watching how these guys interact with each other. They're very similar to dogs, but they're also very, very different than dogs. It's like a primal animal. And that's why it's cool for you guys to see, because a lot of you guys are always asking about my wolf experiences, and some of you guys have maybe never even seen a wolf, even in captive or in wild. I could sit here all day and just try to figure out what they're saying to each other and how they're communicating, but this is a little taste of what I did for 5 summers in Colorado, just watching wolves interact with each other and learning from them and watching their body language and learning how to be in there with them and learning how to keep your body language and learning. That's why when I work with a lot of dogs who are feral, insecure, nervous, beaten, abandoned, abused, have trust issues, like these wolves primally, instinctually do, they have trust issues because they're not supposed to trust humans because they're not supposed to really live with humans. So a lot of the stuff that I learned working with the wolves goes back and copy and paste into the work that I do with a lot of fearful dogs. All right, you guys, so that was really good. Went to a couple stores. Now we're going to Bass Pro Shops, which is one of my favorite stores because there's none of them around us in New York. It's gonna be tons of distractions. It's like eye candy in there for everybody, so we'll see how she does here.
Good. Yes.
Let's work on this, okay? That box dropping is the problem. How do we fix the problem? I think we fix the problem the same way we helped not fix the door, is you do it over and over again without making a big
deal out of it.
Any problem that she has in the beginning, it's a huge deal.
Good girl.
Our job is to run her through this so it's not a big deal. So let's see how she does here with this test. And this goes for any dog dealing with this type of stranger danger stuff, is they're gonna be afraid of something at first, and then you just work through it.
Easy.
Much better. She didn't react at all. Perfect. Pay her and break her. So they haven't been able to go to Bass Pro at all. They haven't been able to go past the little spinny thing at all. She shut down before, and so this is huge progress for them. And again, if we can do this, we can do this. So I'm really hopeful for these guys moving forward. All right, you guys, so right now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go to Target again. And we had a really good day at some stores downtown as well as Bass Pro Shops, building that confidence up and really just giving the owner the know-how and what to do in situations when the dog gets nervous. Interesting case, it's definitely a challenge, which is great for me because I really like things like this. I'm a problem solver. It doesn't matter if it's a service dog, an agility dog, a trick dog, a behavior modification case. I'm a problem solver. That's what my real passion is. So we're gonna go to Target for day two and we're gonna see how she does from here. Up and early for the hope of a brand new day. See a homie you ain't seen since back in the day. Fresh haircut fitted with a fat ass fade. Into work week chilling on a Saturday. How you felt when you first heard the daddy came? Rock MKRS, hey, I had that day. Cooling out with old girl on a fat ass day. Find $100 bill, wow man, that's great. Get promoted at your job up to management. Plot a long time, finally your plan is made. In time I feel I wanna shout, man, it's real that way. Wanna think of things that make you feel that way. Make you feel that way. Christmas Day when your mama got your first bite. Type of feeling when you went in one. 15 minutes ago, when she heard that thing open, she flinched. Now, fast forward to whatever the hell we're doing. It's not dog training. It's just figuring out what works for her. Now let's see how she does.
Wait.
Good. Now you can pay her. Yep. Perfect. Much better. Look, my job is to really evaluate, will this dog, with some of the PTSD that she's dealing with, perform the task that she needs to potentially save the handler's life? And as we progress, what I really like to see, like I said earlier, is that progression. We're taking a little bit of progress, and that means that the dog can get better. So that's really what I like to see. A little nervous of that train. She's dealing with it. Put your leash pressure down. There you go. Good. See if this is good. She's not pulling. She's walking nicely. She's a little nervous. Her tail isn't completely tucked. Look great.
That was great. And even the train's going.
That's what I was saying. The train she got a little nervous about, but her tail never tucked.
Yeah.
It never tucked like it normally did.
Yeah. I am on top of the world right now.
Good. Stay there.
Wait. Good. Let's go.
So what you guys are seeing in this clip is that the owner actually does have an episode. And so what the dog actually does is calmly sits with her, shows her medication, lays on her, does everything that she needs to do in a calm manner. Now the dog is still kind of looking around, which isn't ideal, but at least the dog was able to perform the task very calmly that the handler needed. How do you feel like she did there?
She was completely calm.
Good.
She laid on me, she stayed calm.
Yeah, she was calm, that's for sure.
She bumped you.
So she started getting really antsy, and I had her start actually pulling more because I could feel it in my legs.
Yeah.
And then when she started pulling, she actually was kind of like kept looking because she was trying to multitask, and then it just hit. And then, and she backed up where I could get it, and then she went over top of me. She didn't shake, she was just perfectly neutral and calm like she has always been. It takes time, and it takes understanding, and understanding dogs and understanding what you're looking for. We have a lot of work to do, and it's really going to be up to Stormi and what she wants to do. And the fact that for the first time since the accident, we saw her breakthrough of, I want to be doing this, is so encouraging. You know, it's been 3 months since the accident, and this is the first time I've seen that willingness and that drive. Like, I want to get back at it. I want to get back to work. Mom, take me. You're leaving me. I'm not supposed to be away from you. I'm here to protect you and do my job. And to see that in her and her tail wagging and engaging and reflecting and coming back at me, that's what I can close my eyes tonight and be like, we're on the right track. We got the help that we were looking for. And yes, there will be a time either she's going to want to continue and she's going to progress. But if the progression stops, then we will move forward with that as well. Regardless, she'll always be with me.
In conclusion, in a couple days, they weren't able to bring this dog out in public. Now they can. This dog isn't 100% back to where she was. This dog still has some work to do, but this owner and this dog have an unbreakable bond. And it's really important for both of them to be on the same page and to really work together. So what the owners have to do now is they have to go out and spend time desensitizing all of these loud noises, all of these potential scary things out in public. And I think, like I said, if we've come this far in 2 days, I think the owners over the next couple months can really progress to get back to normalcy and being able to go out and enjoy the dog and the handler safely. I let Ollie take the aisle, told him brand it for me. I get 2 million a pop and that's standard for me. Like I went blind, dog, you gotta hand it to me. Gotta give me.